Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio questions is COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. Question number one, Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what consideration was given to increasing the maximum spend on both long and short campaigns for the forthcoming Scottish local elections in May 2022.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank the member for the question. Expenses limits for Scottish local government elections were updated as part of the recent set of instruments laid before Parliament ahead of May 2022 local elections. Specifically, the representation of people, variation of limits of candidates, local government election expenses, Scotland Order 2021, increased the maximum expenditure limit to £806, together with an additional 7p for every entry in the register of electors. The power of Scottish ministers to vary the limits on candidates' expenditure in local government election campaigns is restricted to changes linked to inflation or the recommendation of the Electoral Commission. The increases made by the recent order was in line with inflation. No further recommendation for change was made by the Electoral Commission.
Paul McLennan.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? Like many colleagues in the SNP and across the Chamber, I know this has been discussed within political parties, particularly in terms of campaigning during COVID. Can he outline future plans for reviewing campaign expenditure in future Scottish local parliament and Scottish local council elections?
Minister.
The Government reviews campaign expenditure limits ahead of each set of parliamentary and local government elections. As noted, the power of the Scottish Ministers to amend spending limits for local government elections is limited unless in response to a recommendation from the Electoral Commission. So I'm confident the Commission will consider any lessons learned in holding of the 2022 elections and will continue to work productively with Commission ahead of any future changes.
Question number two, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impacts of the Omicron variant on the implementation of its COVID-19 recovery strategy.
Deputy First Minister John Spinney.
Presiding Officer, Public Health Scotland is working rigorously to assess how many cases of Omicron there are likely to be in Scotland, and they, together with local test and protect teams, will work to identify how the virus might have been transmitted and to break further chains of transmission. Our response to the new variant will develop as we learn more about the risk it poses and as we find out more about its spread within Scotland. We will continue to closely monitor the situation and be guided by the latest science and clinical advice. We will continue to do all we can to make sure people in Scotland are offered the greatest possible protection through vaccination as quickly as we can. This in turn will help our ongoing progress on recovery. Indeed, Scotland already has the highest vaccination rate of all the UK nations for the first, second and third doses.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. The arrival of Omicron in Scotland is a stark reminder if we needed it. The virus has not gone away. And care workers I speak to, having gone above and beyond in the past 20 months, are once again rightly concerned about how we will support the most vulnerable people in our society. The recovery plan speaks about the importance of fair work in social care. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that a wage of at least £15 an hour would fairly recognise the huge contribution of care workers? And will he call on his colleague, the Finance Secretary, to deliver this in tomorrow's budget to match the aspirations of his recovery plan and give care workers the rise they deserve?
Deputy First Minister. But
I absolutely acknowledge the significance and the importance of the work of employees in the care sector. They have done an absolutely magnificent job in very trying circumstances, and I thank them and admire them for their contribution. The Government, as Mr O'Kane will know, has already taken steps to support and to increase the pay available for the social care staff. The Finance Secretary will make her announcements in due course tomorrow. Mr O'Kane will realise that it's not for me to make statements and comments about these issues today. The Finance Secretary will set out her position to Parliament tomorrow, but I think it has to be acknowledged that the Government has already taken substantial steps to enhance the remuneration of social care workers and also to support the efforts which are proving to begin to show some of the signs of success of improving recruitment in the social care sector as well.
Supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. If we're going to minimise the impact of the Omicron variant, we need to make sure people have access to booster vaccines. I have a constituent who's had the first and second vaccine in Scotland, but has had to move to the south of England for family reasons, and has been told that the only way she can get a booster is to return to Scotland. Now, surely this must be something that can get sorted out between the NHS in Scotland and in the NHS in other parts of the UK. Is it something the Cabinet Secretary can look into?
Deputy First Minister.
If Mr Fraser would care to send me the details of that, I will look into that specific case. I can see no good reason why that should be the case. Certainly, in the light of the information Mr Fraser gives me, it makes no sense for that individual to be requested to come back to Scotland to receive the booster vaccination. So if you'd care to write to me with those details, I'll attend to that.
Before calling question number three, I would note that the member was late to the chamber. And I would be minded not to call the member, but in the interest of any members who may actually wish to put forward a supplementary to this question, I will call the member. However, I would wish, before he asks his question, that he provides an apology and an explanation. Jim Fairley, number three.
My sincere apologies, Presiding Officer. I simply lost track of time, so I do apologise to the Chamber profusely.
Thank you, and please now pose your question, Mr Fairley.
To ask the Scottish Government how its coordination of COVID-19 policies can ensure people living in Perthshire South and Kinrosshire are supported through the recovery of the pandemic.
Deputy First Minister.
President, so despite progress, we know that the impacts of COVID continue to be felt acutely by many individuals, businesses and other organisations across Scotland. We are working closely with local government to implement the shared vision and outcomes of the COVID recovery strategy. And we will continue to work together with local authorities, including Perth and Kinross Council, to shape the recovery activity which will support the rebuilding of local public services, create and sustain good green fair jobs and fair work, drive financial security for low-income households and improve the wellbeing of children and young people.
Jim Fairley.
Given the important role that vaccination is going to play in COVID recovery, efficient rollout of the vaccine is going to be key. Unfortunately, recent changes to the JCVI guidance saw members of the public turning up before they could legally receive their booster, with some staff and volunteers experiencing abuse in our local centre. What cross-government coordination can be put in place to ensure that future changes to the JCVI guidance do not result in a repeat of that unfortunate situation?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, obviously the JCVI advice required us to move at pace to try to ensure that individuals could have access to the booster vaccination. I'm aware of a number of cases, a small number of cases, in the context of the overwhelming scale and success of the vaccination programme, where individuals were inconvenienced because of the change in approach. The necessary advice has been issued to health boards. That has been communicated widely within the healthcare system. The guidance has been updated on the NHS Inform website. We apologise to anyone who was unable to get their booster vaccination, but I'm satisfied that the measures are now in place to ensure that this approach can be put into operational practice at local level to ensure that all the clinical and legal requirements have been met.
Question number four, Pauline McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government when ministers last met with key stakeholders, including business owners, to discuss COVID-19 vaccine certification scheme.
Deputy First Minister.
Sir, a review process over the last few weeks has included ministerial engagement with a range of business sectors, including hospitality, tourism, culture and event sectors most impacted by COVID. The new Omicron variant has refocused both our efforts and these discussions, and has again stressed the importance of our protection measures, including the COVID status certification scheme. Last week, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy met with the Confederation of British Industry, the Federation of Small Businesses, Institute of Directors, the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, Scottish Council of Development Industry and Scottish Financial Enterprise.
Pauline McNeill.
Can I welcome this high level of engagement with the sector? Hospitality sector does welcome the introduction of testing to the certification scheme, but they do note that the scheme will still have an ongoing economic impact. We've seen it from the experience in Wales, where there's a 20% reduction in all trade levels in the sector, and the Scottish Beer and Pub Association have said that they've seen a drop of 40% in trade since the introduction of the COVID passport scheme. That's not just 40% down in normal times. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what more steps can be taken to provide more frequent and widespread communication to the public that they can test before going out to nightclubs and the hospitality sector to allow for more spontaneous visits, of course, where it's safe to do so?
Deputy First Minister.
What Pauline McNeill will be familiar with the delicate balance the government is trying to strike in this matter, whereby we We want business sectors to be able to operate as normally as possible, but we face significant threats and a renewed threat from the Omicron variant into the bargain. So the type of message which the government has been setting out over the course of the last 10 days about increasing the volume of individual testing before socialising or before going out to a retail environment is really important, so that individuals can take more responsibility to make sure they are safe to go out and to circulate. As I indicated in a radio interview earlier on this week, I am now testing myself on a daily basis when I'm likely to be in contact with other members of the public. It's a personal decision of mine to protect my family, but also to make sure that I'm able to exercise my functions in office, but do it safely in relation to others. And I would encourage members of the public to do so. I think an essential point is we've got to make sure there is availability of lateral flow device testing kits. They are freely available on the NHS Inform website, numerous pharmacies, and we're trying to extend the physical availability of those in communities in partnership with local authorities.
Question number five, Dr. Alistair Allen.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies across government will support island communities to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Deputy First Minister.
So we know that the impacts of COVID-19 continue to be felt acutely by many individuals, businesses and other organisations across our island communities. The 30 million Islands programme will ensure delivery of the National Islands Plan and is informed by our learning of how island communities have responded and adapted to COVID-19. We continue to work closely across government and with our island partners to implement the shared vision and outcomes of the COVID recovery strategy, which sets out the actions we will take to address systemic inequalities made worse by COVID-19, to make progress towards a wellbeing economy and accelerate inclusive, person-centred public services.
Alistair Allen.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his reply, and can I ask what can be done to build resilience to ensure that the supply chain issues, which did badly affect some island communities at various points throughout the pandemic, are not repeated in the future?
Deputy First Minister.
Obviously, there is the island communities, and I need share no information about this with Dr. Allen, given his assiduous representation of his constituency, that the island communities are heavily dependent on the ferry connections that provide essential services to the islands in bulk. And obviously we've had instances over the course of the pandemic where staff have had to self-isolate for COVID purposes. That has disrupted the availability of the ferry network. I do assure Dr. Allen, however, that there is a very pragmatic approach taken to try to ensure that island communities are properly and fully serviced by ferry vessels. I noticed that as a consequence today of the disruption because of weather issues, that additional sailings have been put in place by Caledonian McBrain, I think to Castlebay, I think it was, that I noticed earlier on today. So it's an indication that where possible, we will use flexibility and pragmatism to make sure that island communities are properly serviced at a time when there can be unavoidable disruption due to self-isolation and other examples of the COVID pandemic.
Question number six, Emma Harper.
How its policies and actions across government will support Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, the COVID recovery strategy sets out how we will rebuild by working collaboratively across government and with partners in local government, business and the third sector. Recovery priorities will vary by location and local needs, so we will continue to work in partnership to deliver joint leadership that is necessary for this effort. Both Scottish Borders and Dumfries and Galloway will benefit from the Scottish Government's £85 million contribution to the Borderlands Inclusive Growth Deal, which will support a range of projects and programmes designed to drive sustainable economic growth across the region. We have also provided up to £125,000 to support the South of Scotland Regional Economic Partnership to develop the area's first regional economic strategy, establishing a framework and delivery plan for national agencies and regional partners to work together to achieve a sustained and inclusive recovery from the effects of COVID-19.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Across D&G and the Scottish Borders, when COVID-19 protective measures were previously put in place, many businesses welcomed the COVID-19 business support, which was available to keep them afloat. Can the Cabinet Secretary comment on what engagement the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government, given the emergence of the Omicron variant, regarding whether the Treasury will make finances available to the Scottish Government should public health protections be required again?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the First Minister, along with the First Minister of Wales, wrote to the Prime Minister last week to set out a number of practical issues that we believe need to be addressed in relation to the possible implications of the Omicron variant. One of those issues was the possibility that we might see interruption to the operation of business due to additional restrictions that we may have to bring in. And we were making the point in that letter that there was an importance of having a flexible approach across the United Kingdom to make sure that different administrations who may be affected at different times, although these issues might be affected at a similar scale and time across the whole of the United Kingdom, have the financial support available. We welcome the fact that there was support from the Her Majesty's Treasury in relation to earlier stages of the pandemic. As we've reflected in this question time session, that threat has not gone away. It may intensify as a consequence of Omicron. It's likely to intensify as a consequence of Omicron. So we need to have the financial support available, and we'll continue to discuss that with the United Kingdom Government.
A supplementary, Finlay Carson.
Given the vital role that public transport is going to play in the post-pandemic recovery, not just to get young people but others in terms of finding employment and securing employment, as well as returning to social activities, can the Scottish Government give an assurance that the public bus and rail services in my constituency of Galloway and West Dumfries will return to pre-COVID levels, and the recovery of rural areas will not be put at risk through damaging cutbacks?
Deputy First Minister.
I would certainly want that to be the case, and I acknowledge the importance of public transport in ensuring that connectivity is available there for all citizens. It's particularly apparent in an area like Dumfries and Galloway. For the benefit of completeness in relation to this question, the Scottish Borders as well. So yes, that's the objective. The Government has, of course, put in place very significant levels of financial support to sustain the operations of transport providers during the pandemic. Of necessity, that public transport has carried many fewer passengers than would have been the case because of restrictions. But we do want to see a vibrant public transport network that's available to ensure that the needs of all citizens, whether they are accessing college or training places or employment or making connections across the community, are able to be satisfied. I give Mr Carson the assurance the Government is working to that objective, although obviously there's a lot of dialogue to be had about specific services and provision.
Question number 7, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies across government will support families on low incomes to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, increasing financial security for low-income households is one of the central outcomes of our COVID recovery strategy, and we are focused on supporting those most affected during the pandemic. The Scottish Government is taking a range of actions that will transform the lives of many families across Scotland. From April 2022, we are doubling the Scottish Child Payment to £20 per week, which could lift a further 20,000 children out of poverty. This policy is the most ambitious child poverty reduction measure in the United Kingdom and demonstrates our commitment to supporting low-income families as we recover from the pandemic. We are also progressing work to further expand funded early learning and childcare for 1- and 2-year-olds, starting with those from low-income households. Alongside this, we are expanding our free school breakfast and lunch provision, starting with those who need it most.
Jackie Dunbar.
I welcome the announcement from the Scottish Government that the game-changing Scottish child payment will be doubled to £20 in the upcoming budget. What impact will this specific policy have on tackling child poverty as we recover from the pandemic?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, the analysis that's been undertaken so far indicates that increasing the amount of Scottish child payment to £20 could lift 40,000 children out of poverty, reducing overall child poverty by an estimated 4 percentage points in 2023-24. This is based on initial analysis. However, we hope to publish further analysis on this point in early 2022. This will give families of, the families of over 106,000 children under the age of 6 an immediate cash boost when it's introduced in April 2022. We will, of course, look to take other steps to support the financial well-being of low-income families and to make sure that the interventions we make, for example, on the creation of employment or on the expansion of wraparound childcare also is targeted to support these families, to make sure that we use a combination of different interventions, whether it's child payment or whether it's employment support, to enable that we achieve our outcome of reducing child poverty and improving the financial security of low-income households.
Question number 8, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its policies across government will support the North East's recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, we are actively supporting economic recovery in the North East and have provided close to £100 million to support businesses and additional funding to meet particular needs to the tune of £150 million to councils to help achieve that objective. We are also investing £157 million in the Aberdeen City Region and Moray Growth Deals and over £14 million to develop the skills needed to support regional economic recovery. Alongside this, we have recently confirmed our intention to commit £500 million of capital over the next 10 years to support the just transition of the region and the Moray area, to support energy transition, to create jobs and to maximise the region's future economic potential.
Karen Adam.
Thank you. I welcome the investment there in the North East. And, Presiding Officer, as the North East continues to recover from Storm Arwen and now, of course, Storm Barra, many people are not able to schedule or attend their COVID vaccination boosters. With the Omicron variant spreading throughout Scotland, what advice can the Deputy First Minister give to my constituents who have delayed boosters due to the storm disruption?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, a number of vaccination clinics in the northeast of Scotland took the decision to close early on Friday the 26th of November for safety reasons, with concern about the severe weather from Storm Arwen. Some clinics remained closed over the weekend up to Monday the 29th. We understand that all vaccination clinics affected by Storm Arwen have now reopened and are currently operational. Where vaccination appointments were impacted, people were immediately redirected to unaffected vaccination centres rather than having to wait to book their appointment for another day. Health boards have implemented processes to ensure rescheduling of appointments missed due to the storm, including contacting those they hold details for and issuing public communications on this point as well.
And supplementary, Douglas Lumsden.
Deputy Presiding Officer, something that could make a huge impact to the North East recovery is Freeport status for Aberdeen and Peterhead. Will the Cabinet Secretary stop playing petty politics with thousands of jobs and engage with the UK Government's Freeport programme?
Deputy First Minister.
We've fully engaged with the United Kingdom Government's Freeport agenda. We want to make sure it's compatible with the democratic decisions of this Parliament. And this Parliament, I think, by an overwhelming majority, wants the approach to the Freeport concept in Scotland to have at its heart the concept of fair work, and by fair work, the payment of the real living wage. Now, if Mr. Lumsden happened to see the exchange between the Secretary of State for Scotland, Mr. Alistair Jack, and the Member of Parliament for Edinburgh North and Leith, Deirdre Brock, on Monday, he would have seen Mr. Jack confirm that the issue that is at stake here, the issue which the Secretary of State has decided to put a flag in the ground to make the absolute obstacle to resisting agreeing the model we've put forward, is the payment of the real living wage. Yeah, so there we have it, Presiding Officer. The Conservatives want to support a low-wage economy. The bully boys of the Conservative benches are trying to shout me down for simply explaining to them what their Secretary of State for Scotland said to a House of Commons committee chaired by my distinguished colleague, the member for Perth and North Perthshire, Pete Wishart, an excellent House of Commons committee chair, if ever there was one, and my colleague Deirdre Brock, who managed to extract from the Secretary of State that the Tories are only interested in perpetuating low pay.
this government, and I think members on this side as well, are interested in decent pay and fair work, and the sooner the Conservatives join the journey, the better for Scotland.
That concludes portfolio questions on COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business, and we will now move on to the next portfolio questions, which are on net zero, energy and transport. And again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. I call question number one, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the report, A Vision for Scotland's Railways, produced for Scotland's rail unions.
Minister Graeme Day.
The fact that the unions are sharing their ideas and views, and I look forward to discussing these with unions at our next meeting when we arrange that. However, be assured we are pressing ahead to put in place arrangements to mobilise a wholly owned company structure of the Scottish Government for the provision of ScotRail services following expiration of the current franchise. The new ScotRail operator, ScotRail Trains Limited, its management and staff will, I'm sure, share with all of us and the general public a desire for ScotRail to be a world-leading railway service offering value to passengers and the wider economy whilst being financially and environmentally sustainable.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. He didn't actually answer the question, of course, which was what was his response to the report. I'm not sure if he's read it. It's produced for Scotland's four rail unions, and at least it is a vision for the future. We've had nothing like that from the Minister so far, but ScotRail is going to be nationalised in March. We don't know anything about the governance, the staffing, timetables, tickets, rolling stock. We don't know if there's going to be redundancies, but we do know there's going to be a series of big bucks appointments. That's already in process. Can I ask the Minister if he would agree to cross-party talks on nationalisation? Will he agree to make a statement on where we are with this? We're only a few months away, and will he also involve the unions?
Minister.
President Officer, I'll tell you what we won't do, which is what the Tory government's doing south of the border and slashing billions of pounds from rail services. With regard to the various questions that the member asked, I'm actually in the process of writing to the Net Zero Committee, to the convener, his colleague, to outline some of the very information he's looking for, and that will be in the public domain within a matter of days. With regard to a statement, I'm more than happy to provide a statement to Parliament, subject to the Bureau's agreement, early in the year. With regard to the report, yes, I have read it. I was given a copy ahead of its publication. There are a number of aspects of it I think we would all be in agreement with. There are some good suggestions in there. I'm sure Mr Simpson has many good suggestions to make as well, and I'm more than happy to meet him to hear those.
Question number two, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met Falkirk Council to discuss public transport and connectivity within the rural areas of Falkirk East constituency and what was discussed.
Minister Graeme Day.
President Officer, Transport Scotland officials met Falkirk Council representatives on the 15th of November as part of the Forth Valley Regional Transport Working Group, which was established to facilitate collaborative working and engagement for the second Strategic Transport Projects Review. Attendees discussed the emerging draft recommendations, which follows extensive engagement during the course of the review on the transport problems and the opportunities in the region.
Michelle Thompson.
That answer. Many people in the outlying areas of my constituency of Falkirk East feel that they've been left adrift by private companies driven by profit. And whilst I understand that the number of passengers is still below pre-COVID levels, this doesn't mean to say that communities should be cut off for the want of regular and reliable public transport. With that in mind, can the Minister outline what support and encouragement the Scottish Government is providing to local authorities like Falkirk to provide public transport and connectivity to communities, particularly at this stage in the pandemic, and what further steps it's taking to ensure public transport is run for the benefit of our communities and citizens, and not just shareholders?
Minister.
And also, during the pandemic, we've maintained concessionary travel reimbursement and bus operators' grant payments at pre-COVID levels and have made available up to £210 million in additional funding to the end of this financial year. The bus operators receiving that additional funding are not allowed to make a profit and are required to adapt services to current demand have regard to maintaining connectivity and keep services under review in consultation with local transport authorities and the Health Board. COVID support funding is in addition to that provided to local authorities through the block grant for supporting socially necessary service. That sum of money totals £57 million in 2019-20. Looking to the future, the Transport Act 2019 provides local transport authorities with a range of enhanced options to improve bus services in their area, and we are presently analysing responses to the consultation on the secondary legislation required to implement these.
And supplementary, Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Rural villages across Falkirk would benefit from safer streets and improved connectivity. Will the Minister agree to an urgent review of Scottish Government policy and guidance with regards to 20-mile-per-hour zones in rural villages, especially in the villages of Reading Muirhead and Airth, where residents have long campaigned for such zones to support Falkirk Council to meet community demands?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, we covered that specific issue extensively in the Member's recent Members' debate, and as he well knows, we have plans to bring forward a review of the presumptions around 20-mile zones across the whole of Scotland, not just in his region.
Question number three, Joe Fitzpatrick, who is joining us remotely.
Will provide an update on its pilot to provide free bicycles.
Mr. Fitzpatrick, I'm sorry, we didn't hear the very beginning of your question. Could you please repeat your question from the beginning? Thank you.
Sorry. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its pilots to provide free bicycles for school-aged children.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 17th of August, we announced the first six pilot projects selected to offer free bicycles for school-aged children who can't afford one. These pilots are currently underway across the country. And since then, a further four pilots have been launched, including a pilot on Shetland, and a pilot specialising in the provision of non-standard bikes, which are modified to fit the needs of an individual rider. To date, 242 bikes have been issued, and the pilots have ambitious plans to deliver considerably more this month and beyond.
Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank the Minister for his answer. The Minister is, I know, aware that the Dundee Cycle Hub in my constituency, operated by Dundee and Angus Cycle Hub, is participating in the pilot project delivering free bikes for school-aged children in Dundee. I wonder if the Minister can provide any indication on the number of bikes that have been provided and are expected to be provided to children in Dundee over the course of the pilot.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Yes, indeed. The Angus Cycle Hub pilot is based on a central bike distribution centre for the Angus and Dundee areas, with regional support provided by dedicated development workers and bike mechanics. This pilot is providing specialist support for young people and marginalised families in Angus and Dundee to engage with cycling, active travel, health and wellbeing opportunities. 105 bikes have been delivered to date. 127 additional applications for bikes have been received, and 502 bikes have been ready to go by the Angus Cycle Hub.
Question number four, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is available to residents in Motherwell and Wishaw who are in fuel poverty.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
The Scottish Government's local area-based scheme and National Warmer Homes Scotland scheme are available in all areas of Scotland. These are designed to make homes warmer and cheaper to heat for those living in or at risk of fuel poverty. Since 2013, the Scottish Government has allocated over £21 million to in funding for North Lanarkshire Council as part of our area-based scheme. Our winter support fund includes £10 million for a fuel insecurity fund, which will ensure direct financial support is available to those who are at risk of self-disconnection or self-rationing as a result of increased energy prices this winter.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. The UK energy market is quite frankly broken. We see some of the highest energy prices in Europe, the highest hikes in recent months, and this is evidenced by the fact that so many of the providers are going into administration, causing more stress to my constituents who are already worried about the fuel poverty. What protections are in place for constituents who find themselves in the situation of an energy provider entering administration?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think the member makes a good point about the existing structural problems with the UK energy market, which is largely broken down into two types of company, those who have hedged on energy markets and those who are unhedged on energy markets. And the consequence of very significant spikes in energy wholesale prices has resulted in a significant number of those who are unhedged companies find themselves in very serious financial difficulty and, as a result, withdrawing from the market and leaving customers in difficult positions. She will be aware that the present structure of the regulation of the energy market is a responsibility of the UK Government. As it stands, a customer whose supplier is no longer able to provide them with a service, they are covered by Ofgem supplier of last resort process, which has been designed to minimise disruption in such an event where the customer should wait to be contacted by the new supplier that is allocated by Ofgem. However, if the member has any constituents who are experiencing difficulties with these issues with a new supplier, then they should contact Advice Direct Scotland directly, who will be able to provide them with advice and support on the issue.
And I'll call a supplementary from Liam Kerr, but he will, of course, be aware that the question per the Business Bulletin relates to the people of Motherwell and Wishaw. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It also relates to fuel poverty. And, of course, in March, the UK Government awarded Aberdeen Council £2.2 million to retrofit homes to save households around £450 a year and keep them out of fuel poverty. Now, Aberdeen has a great deal of older granite housing stock, so decarbonisation will present huge costs. So what estimates has the Scottish Government done of the cost of retrofitting these granite houses, and what financial help will be given to Aberdeen Council to tackle this older and specific granite housing stock?
Before I ask the Cabinet Secretary to respond to that, could I just stress that the question on the Business Bulletin, of course, says what support is available to people in the Motherwell and Wishaw constituency who are in fuel poverty. I think that's quite clear, but obviously the Cabinet Secretary presumably would be able to respond to Mr Kerr's
and Deputy Presiding Officer, is that granite properties in the constituency of Motherwell and Wishaw, I suspect, will be of a similar difficulty in being able to tackle some of the insulation issues that they may have, as they have in areas such as the north-east of Scotland. What I can say to the member is that I do welcome the very small amount of investment that's been made by the UK Government to try and assist in some of this work. However, he will be mindful that we have invested some £430 million over the course of the period since 2013 in this area alone. And we've increased our funding this year yet again in order to help to support the area-based scheme so it can assist local authorities in areas such as Motherwell and Wishaw, and of course also in areas such as the north-east of Scotland going forward.
Question number five, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to improve road safety on the trunk road network.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, Scotland has some of the safest roads in the world, but despite the success, each collision and injury is traumatic for everyone involved, and more remains to be done to reduce collisions. We've achieved substantial reductions in accidents and casualties through targeted programmes of investment on trunk roads and joint working with road safety partners. Members might wish to know that across 42 assessed countries in Europe and beyond, Scotland currently has the 8th lowest fatality level, but we are not complacent in any way at all, and we continue to look at where we can make further improvements.
And Finlay Carson.
Thank the Minister for his response. As he will be aware, a trial on the A9 for HGVs over 7.5 tonnes raised speed limits from 40 to 50 miles an hour. This move brought it in line with other trials taking part in the rest of the UK, which critically has resulted in a steady reduction in the number of collisions and casualties, as it addressed one of the main frustrations, and that's driver frustrations with slow-moving lorries. In the last 5 years, there's been 170 accidents in the A75, 9 of which were fatal. As the main route to the ferry ports of Cairnryan, there is a disproportionately high number of HGVs on the road compared with other trunk roads. So will the Scottish Government commit to reviewing HGV speed limits along the A75 with appropriate speed cameras to improve safety and reduce fatalities as a matter of urgency?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Department for Transport published their 3-year evaluation on the effects of increasing speed limits in England and Wales, but that showed that there was statistically no significant change in the number of accidents involving at least one HGV on all single and dual carriageway
roads. That said, we will use the evaluation from that alongside the A9 project, and indeed we are using that because as part of the National Speed Management Review set out in the delivery plan for the recently published Scotland's Road Safety Framework to 2030, that is a work stream and it has commenced.
And supplementary, Maggie Chapman.
Can I thank the Minister for the information he's provided? Can I ask specifically about average speed cameras and how they can improve safety? What analysis has been done on both the A9 and the A90, given the introduction of average speed cameras on those roads? And could those same mechanisms be applied on the A96?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm happy to write to the member with the analysis that she's looking for. But with regard to the A96, we deploy safety cameras where they have the greatest potential to reduce injury collisions and where there's evidence of both collisions and speeding. On the A96, there are a number of mobile camera sites, including a new site at Baines Hole, which became operational in April 2021. Regular camera deployments continue to take place to encourage good driver behaviours, compliance with the speed limit and a continued high level of safety on that route.
Question number 6, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made in 2021 to adopt greener bus transport across Scotland.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government committed over £71 million in the year to 31st March 2021, supporting the purchase of 272 zero-emission buses awarded under the Scottish Ultra-Low-Emission Bus Scheme and unlocking over £71 million of private investment from bus operators. A new Scottish Zero Emission Challenge Fund was launched this year, aiming to support the bus finance and energy sectors to establish a self-sustaining market for zero-emission buses and infrastructure. Bids have been submitted and are currently being assessed. This will further support significant change in the bus market in favour of zero-emission technologies.
Liz Smith.
Could I thank Mr Day for his answer? And he's well aware that improving both bus and train transport is absolutely key in terms of persuading the public to go green rather than rely on extensive use of their cars. So can I ask Mr Day what his reaction is to the fact that First Buses have cancelled altogether the X53 service from Stirling to St Andrews and that Stagecoach has reduced the X56 service between Perth and Edinburgh, both of which are causing constituents across Mid-Scotland and Fife very serious inconvenience?
Minister.
Officer, as I outlined in a previous answer, the relationship between the Scottish Government and the bus operators at this time is very clearly laid out. I think one of those services that she's referring to will be the subject of a members' debate next week, when we'll be able to explore that in detail. Clearly, we want to encourage the bus operators, especially during the pandemic, to maintain as many services as possible, recognising, of course, that some of the issues that have arisen with the buses are down to driver shortages.
And question number 7 has been withdrawn. Question number 8, Jimmy Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to support the energy sector in the West Scotland region.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government have ambitious plans for offshore wind in Scotland, but this needs to come with economic returns, which ensure that our local supply chain companies can benefit from the opportunities this deployment presents. We are committed to co-designing a series of just transition plans for regions and sectors across the country, including the west of Scotland. Work on the energy strategy refresh and just transition plans has already begun, and it will consider how communities the length and breadth of Scotland can benefit from the transition to net zero.
Jamie Green.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that Reactor 3 at Hunterston B nuclear power station was switched off last week after 45 years of service, supplying electricity to 1.7 million homes. It has also supplied thousands of much-needed local jobs and contributes £54 million to the North Ayrshire economy every single year. Can I ask, therefore, given that decommissioning itself will create very limited job opportunities, why there is still no clear or obvious government plan for any so-called just transition to renewable energy jobs for the hundreds of families who currently rely on that site for both employment and economic prosperity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Epstein Officer, the approach that the Scottish Government takes to energy and the development of energy projects is set out in our existing energy strategy, which the member will be aware is not supportive of the introduction of what is very costly and an expensively subsidised industry, which is the nuclear industry. Now, I recognise that the decommissioning work at Hunterston B will be a long-term project which will obviously maintain and retain employment within the area over an extended period of time. But the priority for this Scottish Government is to make sure that we build an energy system which is based upon targeting not only our renewable sector in onshore and offshore wind, but also in tidal marine and in the use of storage. And we'll set out in more detail as we move forward with our energy strategy refresh, which will be published next year.
And supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the renewable energy sector in West Scotland would be better placed to attract renewable investment if the UK Government did not continue to impose transition charges higher than anywhere else in the UK, which impose an unfair financial burden on firms seeking to invest in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Member makes a very important point, and this is an issue which has been recognised across the energy sector for many years, is that it is within Scottish waters and also in some land-based projects that Scottish energy developments are the most expensive to take forward than any part of the UK as a result of the UK's transmission network. And the need for that to be reformed has been required for many years. I welcome the fact that Ofgem have now indicated that they are open to considering a possible review of this. This needs to be taken forward at pace because it is having a negative impact on the sector and the potential economic and environmental benefits that can come from greater renewables. But this type of regulatory system that is stacked against Scottish developments is unacceptable and is one of the actions that the UK Government need to take forward at pace in order to correct it.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.